We have Pragasudha Garu from UK joining us today. She is an associate lecturer and also award-winning dancer. She uses this particular dance not only to perform and entertain, but she also, uses this dance to inculcate a message behind. And she is also part of a lot of social and cultural importance, activities. She is also a founder of a group called Sanskriti Center, which basically carries out research for a lesser seen tribal dances. So basically, she is creating importance for the tribal dances of India, which are not so prominent. And she feels that, they also need importance so that is maintained. And she publishes booklets. She's pretty good at languages and carrying the Indian languages forward. She has got awesome articulation with Telugu and English, the short conversations we had. And she believes in women entrepreneur empowerment and child empowerment, and especially with performing arts. So that's a bit about what I know. But Raga Garu, thanks for joining in. Maybe you can give us overview of how it started, and how are you at this moment, how are you continuing your passion for art, where a lot of people are forgetting it? How are you planning to continue this?
Namaste, Ravi Shankar ji. Thanks a lot for having me today on your program, and namaskar all the viewers who are watching this program. My journey, obviously, like anybody else, like any other artist, has started in the childhood. My father was the one who decided for me that I should go into dancing. And I come from a family of musicians, basically. My grandmother was a Veena exponent, and she used to teach music. She used to live on her own. We were in Hyderabad for my father's job, but obviously she was in our village. And then of course, after her marriage, she moved out from her father's place, and then ever since she continued into music. So ideally, like any other dynasty, she wanted me to go into Carnatic vocal and Veena, which she was good at. But my father said, "Oh, we have a lot of musicians in the family. Let her go into dancing." So he was the decision maker at the time. I don't think at the age of 8 or 7 I would have taken my decision. So I can say the journey, the germination has started there. Then my guru, Dr. Uma Rama Rao, has chiseled me into whatever I am here today. So 20 years, more than 20 years of journey. And after marriage, from my Janmabhoomi, I came to Karmabhoomi. So I'm in the UK for the past, in London for more than 12 years now. And I have been teaching when I was in India, same subject. So I was into cultural tourism and tourism management and travel management, and those were my subjects. So I used to teach those courses in Hyderabad, then moved out to UK. But yes, I was traveling quite a bit. I went to Canada, I went to Singapore, I went around for conferences and meetings and stuff. So if you say my journey, then I have a cultural journey and I have a professional journey. And luckily, both have gone hand in hand. So nothing has stopped for the other one, excepting when obviously, when I became a mother, I was blessed with a baby girl. I had taken a break. I had taken a sabbatical for 2 years, 2 to 2.5 years. Excepting that, the journey had been wonderful. And I feel as artists, we evolve. So what you do, the choreographies you do, or the subjects you take maybe 15 years ago would be entirely different from what probably we do now.
True.
And I think I speak for the whole fraternity when I'm talking about my own journey, that when you are fresh from the oven, your guru has done the Arangetram for you or Ranga Pravesham in Kuchipudi. So those you then you are focusing on the repertoire items. So Alarim Pooja, Tiswaram, Shabdam, Varnam, Tilana, these are Kshetre Padalu and all this. But after that, I think with Guru's blessings again, you evolve into a different personality altogether. And then you start thinking about, okay, how about this? How about that? Let me take something which is very worth creating awareness, but not much awareness has been created. So I went into, I think, that direction. where I have cultivated an interest in the lesser spoken topics or the lesser known topics and something. Look, I have completely gone research oriented after that. And yes, we have some here and there, some feathers in cap and, you know, some ikalu and tokalu, they say in Telugu. So some feathers definitely we have. And as I said, it's a journey. And when you say journey, it's also the apparatus or the mechanism that is taking you there. So the supporters, the organizers who have given me opportunities, who have believed in me that, okay, if we ask Raga Sudha to do this, she will do it. So the confidence that they have bestowed in me, all that matters. You know, 15 years, 16 years is not a small time either, not a short term. So yes. So that has probably given me these milestones, my records and my awards and whatever I have today. Quite thankful to all those opportunities.
Nice. So how did it start? I mean, you said, you know, your parents have done this, but how did this start in UK? How did you, you know, come to a different place and, you know, thought that Indian culture can also be spread across here, and you know, some of these performing arts, it might be very difficult. So how did this thought process happen there?
Okay, so I came with a background. So while I was in India, obviously I performed in my guru's ballets and in all the opportunities that she has provided us with. After I moved to UK, you know, I have to actually give a little background about the place. So my husband was here, therefore, after marriage, I have moved here. But I moved to a place called Manchester before coming to London. So we were there for about 2 years. Now, with the diaspora living in the UK, we have had this trajectory of migration. So a lot of people, Indian background people, have come from Uganda, from Kenya. So there have been these trajectories of migration. So they have been coming here in 70s, 80s, 90s. You know, say in installments. And by the time I came, obviously there was a second generation of Indian diaspora, third generation of Indian diaspora, who have already had this, I mean, have even today, this complete system, ecosystem, where, you know, they have a huge support, huge, you know, either families or friends, or, you know, they have this system. So when I came after marriage, trust me, I did not even know an ant in this country, literally. I mean, I had to start from literally scratch. I mean, when I say scratch, it's scratch, literally. So I had to, you know, I had to find out about, okay, who are the organizations, who are the people, or what are the processes. At that time, probably I was more an individual, struggling myself with information, because I obviously did not have god uncle, god auntie, god brother. I did not have anybody. So it was quite a bit of journey, I should say. Then once I started performing, job-wise, I never had a problem. I was in the UK, within 2 months, I got a job. So I'm not at all talking about my professional journey. That had been excellent, wonderful, and no qualms at all. But with cultural journey, I had taken some time to settle down, to understand, and to see who the players are, and, you know, what are the expectations, or what are the, you know, what are the deliverables that are required. So, and again, as I say, I go back to this again and again. I'm always, always thankful, 15, 16 years now, but I'm always thankful to the organizers, to the people who supported me, to the people who believed in me, to the people who gave me opportunities, all these people. So, so in Manchester, I had an opportunity to teach in Bharti Vidya Bhavan, obviously, you know, institutional support also I had, started my journey there. Performing, yes, I have been performing solos here, there, everywhere, festivals, occasions, events. With that background, I came to London. But people have been, you know, people who saw my work, people who saw my articulation, people who saw my disposition, they have given me some references to, you know, to carry my work in London as well.
So you do have societies there, or, you know, you do have community centers or stages where you can, or theaters which are customizable, or where you can go and perform, available?
Yes. I mean, see, with reference to Indian diaspora, of course, you know, huge, huge diaspora with several linguistic backgrounds. And now, I think after 12 years, I also see that, you know, there are quite active regional diaspora groups as well, which probably were not there 12 years ago or 10 years ago, but they have literally consolidated themselves very well in the past few years. But Indian arts, whether it is music or dance, performing arts, are actually respected and accepted very well by the British society as well. Now, when I'm saying British society, I'm not talking about British Indians. I'm talking about British. Okay. So the non-Indians. So they have great respect. And if we are doing things the right way, and if we are doing it sincerely without any agenda, then obviously, I mean, you excel. Everybody excels. So, yes, we have very good theatres, stages and community centres, several. And up and down the country. I'm not just London-centric. I'm just talking about, of course, 2-3 places I know because I have a continuous engagement with those places. But otherwise, as I said, up and down the country, you have different types of auditorium, I mean, different places that you can perform and carry it forward.
Nice, Andy. So we also want to know more about you. So, you know, we have some rapid fire questions. So are you all set so that we can ask these questions?
Well, when you say, are you all set? I don't know how I should be set. But yes, I'm ready for the questions. And yeah.
You're ready for the questions.
Let's take it the way it comes.
Yeah. What is that one hidden talent, apart from what all performing arts you have mentioned, you know, one thing which we are not aware, I mean, anybody, you know, very, except for very close friends of yours, you know, other people who just, you know, see or fans of yours or, you know, people like me, new friends are not aware. What is that hidden talent?
Well, you said hidden. So obviously it was hiding all the time. You know. Basically what I have discovered because of COVID, you know, the crisis that we have had last 3 months, we were all doing a lot of things online, and you know, obviously the whole artistic community has changed, you know, the way they used to either sing or, you know, perform.
Right.
So everybody has come on virtual platforms. And then recently, for the World Health Day, we have done what is called as Vaidyokti. So Vaidyokti means we have actually worked with 20 different linguistic communities and doctors.
Mm-hmm.
And we have taken their inputs and poems in their own mother tongue about coronavirus, how they see.
Okay.
Because they are the frontline people. They are actually treating the patients or seeing death so closely. And of course, they are also human beings apart from being professionals. So not always tight-lipped.
Mm-hmm.
But they will have their own emotions and feelings as
yeah.
well. So they have all the doctors from gastroenterologists to psychiatrists to gynecologists to radiologists, everybody have given the poems in their own mother tongue, and we published it. And then what we wanted to do, of course, I'm a dancer, so my vacuum is always in the dancing, you know, that area. So we said, okay, some of the languages at least we can dance, and you know, we can give the message to the wider community, because coronavirus was not just your problem, my problem, not even a problem in India. It's like a global problem.
Global issue.
So we really wanted to do it as a dance. So through the dance, we wanted to give a social message. So we picked up 2 lines from this, 2 lines from that. So about 9 languages, we prepared a script. Now, the challenge was the tune, because mm-hmm. you need a tune for the song and then we can dance on it. So never did I do that before in my life, because we always have this Tyagaraja Kirtanas, Sambhas Kirtanas, Annamacharya Kirtanas set for us. We record the music if we are not doing the live program, and the gurus are always there to help with choreographies and stuff. So I was not so independently doing the composing and, you know, all that. But for the first time in my life, I realized that I could actually do a tune for a song. So the one which is there, it is there on YouTube as well, COVID Kartavyam. So the tune of that song, I sat for about maybe half an hour, 1 hour, and I said, okay, this tune, no, not looking nice. Okay, this tune, no. Okay, this tune. So I was experimenting with it and I came out with a tune. And then I never expected that I could do that. So completely, I don't say it's a talent, but it is something that came out thanks to Corona. But this has come out, you know, out of blue. Never did I try, never did I imagine, never did I dream, but it just came out. So yeah, maybe a hidden talent, and maybe I can polish it further. We never know, but yes, proud of it.
Cool. Yeah, good one. So how do you take breaks? You know, one of the things which I realize is most of the time, you know, the performing arts are, and these events are conducted during weekends. And, you know, it's okay for performer, you know, artists who are only doing this because, you know, they get a chance, they get the entire weekday rest, and then, you know, they're performing during the weekends on, you know, holidays or, you know, during festivals. But when you're working, you know, it becomes very difficult. That's the time you want to relax during the weekend, and you have this. So how are you balancing your work as a lecturer and, you know, the dance?
I think my energy levels are high. I mean, we all have different energy levels. So I noticed that probably my energy levels are high, number one. Otherwise, we all have 24 hours in a day. Nobody is having more or less. Every human being on this earth has 24 hours in a day. So it's also time management. And there are times where even I feel exhausted, because then I'm focusing more on certain event-oriented choreographies or, you know, the arrangements or, you know, organizing, training. I have my classes. And it's actually quite ironic, because during the working days, Monday to Friday, of course, you're busy with your own university curriculum, the number of hours and the marking of scripts, etc.
Right.
Weekends get busier. So weekends are not, in most of our cases, who are into arts or taking classes, I'm talking about all the dance teachers, all the music teachers, weekends get much tighter with time. So then you feel like, okay, now, you know, maybe let me watch a fun movie, or maybe let me do this, let me do that. So it's time management. It boils down to time management. And there is nothing like a break. I mean, because your mind is always working.
Yeah.
So even if I'm not doing something physically, my mind is still planning, okay, after 2 months, 3 months, this is coming up. So I'll have to start, you know, making preparations for that. So the mind is never at rest.
Ma'am, you have to move a bit towards your left. So I think you're coming. Yeah, just a bit. Okay. Yes. Yeah.
This fine?
Yeah, this is perfect. Thanks a lot. So the next question. So after all this, you know, we were talking about breaks. So how do you take a break? What do you do during summer breaks? And what's your mantra for a break from your regular routine and being in the same place? Where do you go?
Music. Music has a very, very therapeutic property, healing property, I would say. So if there is nothing like, when, as I told you, there is nothing like we are not doing anything. If you're not moving your hands or legs or eyes, the mind is still working, excepting when you are sleeping. Probably even in sleep, probably we are dreaming. So there is nothing like a complete silence without any activity. So I feel, and this is also something I'm very keen about, that music, okay, we listen to, you know, old songs, and we listen to a lot of film songs, maybe classical songs, kirtanas and bhajans and all that. Whatever it is, whatever our bent of mind is, whatever our taste is, but music actually has a lot of healing property, as I said. So it also treats a lot of serious problems, like mental problems, illnesses, and, you know, so my own personal experience has been that I'm very fond of songs from the beginning.
Okay.
So if I'm in the area of dancing, then I'm too much into classical, you know, as I said, kirtanas and all that. But otherwise, then I'm a lot into old songs and, you know, those lyrically rich compositions, Hindi, Telugu, some of the other language, German, because I studied in Germany. So I have that penchant for German music as well. So I listen to a lot of music.
Okay. How did
That's
this...
my semester.
Yeah, how did this, a profession as a lecturer happen? I mean, do you always wanted to be a lecturer, or, that happened as an opportunity which crossed by?
Who doesn't like lecture bazi, Ali? Who doesn't? Everybody wants to know. I'm just joking. Lighter way. Yes, I always wanted to go into teaching, because when I was a student myself, school, junior college, or degree college, I did, you know, from a very early age, I realized that teacher is somebody who can actually create more, you know, battalions. Mm-hmm. So through the training, through education, they are the people who will, if I'm talking to you, I'm just talking to you. But if I'm teaching, then I'm teaching 50 students. So whatever knowledge I have, whatever I know, can be imparted to 50, 100, 20, 10, maybe 1,000. And it spreads, the knowledge spreads. And that I always found very fascinating, very revered and respected. I always wanted to go into teaching.
Nice. So next question, if you could pass on any wisdom of yours, okay, to a student, what would you do? What would you share?
Sincerity,
mm-hmm.
hard work, commitment,
okay.
and resilience.
Resilience.
These are the qualities that are required, because we also have been seeing off late lot of people who break down because probably they are not getting timely opportunities, or somebody is trying to bring them down, and this
right.
we see a lot. People who, I mean, unfortunately, we do have people who cannot tolerate others' successes. Maybe, you know, loko bhinna ruchihi. So our own four fingers are not of one type or one size. So we do have these personalities who probably are, you know, not really a very accommodative type. So when somebody is trying to bring you down, or when you are not getting opportunities that probably you feel you deserve, you should not give up. Continue. Resilience is important. So continue. You will, for what you rightfully deserve, there will be a moment for you, for yourself. So this is something I would pass on. I mean, wisdom, not any academic knowledge or any theory or anything, but this is wisdom, because I've seen them myself. You just have to take time and then remain calm. It's difficult. When you know somebody is in a combat, it is very difficult to maintain calm, and then you end up taking wrong decisions as well. But yes, I think patience and commitment to the cause, dedication is very important, and that's what I will tell everybody.
If we have to relate you with a quote or saying that you have lived your life by some other personality or some other story attached, Do you have something to relate to?
Okay. Okay. So probably something that is little bit closer to my heart. I mean, there will be many. If you start thinking and take time, and maybe so many things pass your mind, but this is something which is actually crossing my mind at the moment. Two things actually. A journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step. Of course, this is not what I said, but something which is more closer to my heart would be, do not complain that the rose bush has thorns. Mm-hmm. Rejoice that the thorn bush bears roses. So, I mean, seeing positivity in everything that you come across would be something that I would relate myself to.
What is the most notorious thing you've done in your college life?
Oh. I was actually quite notorious. I wouldn't say notorious, but mischievous, yes.
Yeah.
college life. Okay, so I have to think about college life now. Mm. Well, like probably many others, we used to bunk. I mean, I have a science background. So in my junior college, my father wanted me to become a doctor. So I have taken botany, zoology, chemistry, physics. So, but practicals would be very, I mean, you know, we will be 15, you know, 14, 15, right after 10th class, you are into your junior college. And suddenly you have these 2 hours, 3 hours practicals in the lab, and you're standing and mixing chemicals and pipette and burette, and, you know, that each drop falling down and the chemicals turning colors, and we were like, okay. So what we used to do, I mean, me and two other, I should say, hand in glove. So we were like partners in crime. So what we used to do, we were in a group as it was all group work. So we will have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 groups, and we are supposed to note down the readings and then give the readings back to our lecturer. So what we used to do, and we our college was in the heart of, I mean, it was in Abbots. So we were in the center of everything. So at that time, we had Santosh Sapna. All these theaters were around our college. Yes. So it was a movie which was, you know, we could literally, not telling our parents, but if we can manage a matinee show, saying, oh, we got tired, we had an hour extra lesson, and you go back at 5:30, you know, go back home. So what we used to do, we used to actually ask our other friends, other groups, okay, can you tell us your readings? You know, what is it, 1.2 or, you know, 3.8, whatever. So we used to note down those readings and bunk and go to the movies. We didn't do it a lot, but whatever we did.
Yeah, those are memorable. You know, those are the things. You know, if you do it regular, I think you'll not remember them.
No. Once, sometimes, you know, oh my God, who will stand for 2 hours? Not again, you know, because we used to have every week practicals. So, I mean, if my college friends are actually watching this, then they will know who they are. So, basically, so we used to take the readings from other students. Such like, what is the reading? Give. And then we used to, because we have to give back to the teacher as well. We have to submit it back to the teacher. Okay. So, at the end of 5 minutes, this was the reading. And maybe at the end of 8 minutes, this was the reading. There will be some readings.
Yes.
We did it a couple of times. And I think everybody has that phase where, you know, you're a little bit mischievous when you are growing up. So, but then today, you know, they are all very nice memories. Oh, you know, oh my God, did I do that? Was it me who did that? You know? So very nice. Even in school, I was very mischievous.
So how was the commute between school to your home? And, you know, were there any memories during the commute?
During the commute, yeah. So actually, we used to live not very far from the from where I studied. I studied in Stanley. So I have a very close friend who was 2-3 minutes away from home, and then we studied in the same class together. Class, not even same school or college, same class. So we used to sit in the same classroom as well. She is now settled in New Zealand, Pratibha. We used to walk. Hmm. It's about 10 to 12 minutes. We are not very far. So we never used to take rickshaws, or I never expected my father to drop me and all that. So we used to just walk. She used to come and we used to walk to the, you know, to the classes.
So which class is it? Which class is it, so that we understand what height you are? I mean, because we are imagining, right, while you're talking.
So 11th class, if we
okay,
have
now,
to.
Yeah, now we can imagine what height and what dress you are
wearing. Yeah. Of course, if you're too small, then your parents are dropping you, or the rickshaw will come, the auto will come, so the school bus will come. So where we are a little bit independent and not too independent as well. So we are monitored by parents at that age, but still we are managing on our own. So 11th class, I should say, 11th and 12th. And then on the way back, we were very studious. We were mischievous, but I was the mischievous one, not she. So when on the way back, we really literally, I mean, I don't know how we managed that. We used to open our record, literally. So whatever we had, botany or physics or whatever we had, even assuming English or any other. So we used to literally open the book, and the whole way long on the road while walking, we had an open book like this in hand, and we used to, oh, you know, we did this. And probably people used to think we were mad. I mean, we didn't have to be so studious, but we were, I think, very eager learners. So, Pratibha, if you're seeing me from New Zealand, this is for you. So, we used to do that. All the road, we used to literally keep the book open in front of us and keep talking about it, keep looking at it. And only when we had to cross the road, that's when we used to be a little bit alert.
Thank God the traffic was not that bad. Traffic was not that bad those days, luckily.
No, we were walking on the pedestrian side, so, not much fine. Of a danger. I mean, we wouldn't be so careless as well. But, you know, that's one memory probably. It came to my mind when you asked.
Yeah.
It just was.
Have you seen this movie, 96?
Sorry?
Have you seen this movie, 96? Or, you know, it was remade as Janu, I think. You know, it's basically of... the pass outs of 98, 96.
No, I don't think I watched that movie. Yeah, is it Hindi movie or?
It's a Telugu movie. The original one is Tamil. The 96 is Tamil. And then it was remade recently last year. And it's worth, I mean, it will bring in a lot of nostalgic.
Such memories, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah.
We were mischievous in our own way. I mean, we are talking about 15, 16, 17 years ago. So we were mischievous in our own way.
So do you still have a group where you connect with your school and college friends?
Actually, My school, my primary school was different from my junior, you know, so I have got, so there is, I mean, and the degree college was Nizam College, so we have a Nizamians group. Of course, we couldn't connect everybody, but yes, most of us are in touch on Facebook and stuff like that. And school, I think, I'm in touch with some. I'm in touch with Prasanna, who was my closest friend in school, Prasanna Lakshmi Reddy. So she, we were like always first rank, second rank. I mean, we used to compete with each other a lot. And that all those games, I don't think Kachakailu, Numbers Langdi, I don't even know whether anybody is playing now. So we used to play all those in school. So some of my schoolmates I'm in touch with, and we are actually trying to connect with others. You know, after marriage, I think we just moved out, and at that time WhatsApp was not there. But now we are, I mean, now in the sense, last 2-3 years, we are trying to, you know, we were planning for a reunion actually. So hopefully yeah. that will happen.
So talking about this, I mean, question from a backbencher to, you know, one or two ranking all the time. So how were you treating the backbenchers at your, you know, time?
Did I even like, say I was a backbencher? No. I was never a backbencher.
No, I'm saying from a backbencher to somebody who ranked. I mean, that's you who is always ranked one or two.
No, but having said that, if we didn't want, for example, you know, after lunch, especially when we were in degree college, after lunch, it would be very difficult to, you know, really focus, especially if you have had a heavy lunch. So some of the classes, especially at 2:30, 2:45, you know, those classes, you know, we never were not fighting for the first row at all. Otherwise, in the morning, we always fight for the first row, you know, literally running and, you know, putting that bag or hanky or whatever. This is my place, this is my chair. But for the afternoon sessions, we were very relaxed. I said, haan, theek hai, aapko baithna hai kya? Okay. So we were backbenchers in the sense for one or two classes, maybe, you know, sometimes, but otherwise, yeah, mostly.
Yeah. My intention was basically, did you discriminate people who were not ranking well?
Oh, no, never. Not after a certain age, because in when you're very small, then you're proud of being, you know, having the first rank, second rank, third rank. We had another in the school, we were in 7th class, 6th class, 8th class. We had another girl, Sujata, Prasanna, me and Sujata, we always were like in the first 5 ranks always. And there were 2 more boys, Naeem and Hassan, I think. I mean, can't remember all the names, but we were all like those first 5 ranks. So we probably had a girls versus boys. I studied in a co-ed school and so was my degree as well. So we were always competing with boys. I mean, not among ourselves, but next time, half yearly exam, he got the rank. Final exam, we have to get the rank. So discrimination in serious context was never there. You know, those innocent, you know, those, oh my God, they must have studied. We should also study. That kind of competitive spirit we may have had in academic subjects, but no, discrimination, no way.
I like the way, you know, you're answering some of these and, you know, clearly describing what the situation out there. So that makes me ask another question related to the same thing. So when we're talking about co-ed education and, you know, education where, you know, only girls study, did you see any difference from, you know, these two schools or colleges where it is like completely girls college and there is a co-ed? So, do you see any behavioral changes in women or girls in these two?
Okay, so
based on this is completely
by profession. I mean, I'm teaching now. Now, I mean, even when I was in India, so what I observe is I'm not saying 100% that will happen, but yes, this input of mine may hold some water. We have, of course, people from different backgrounds and beliefs and, you know, certain social norms within us. So what happens is some people believe, okay, girls have to be in the girls. I taught in St. Francis College. I taught in St. Anne's College, which were completely girls colleges, degree colleges, because the subject that I was teaching, travel management, at the time, I was not married at that time yet. There were very few people who could teach those IATA subjects and, you know, the travel management subjects. So these colleges used to call me maybe twice a week for an hour or so. So I was a visiting lecturer for them, teaching these at that time they were vocational courses and not like a degree, 3-year degree. Yeah. They were vocational courses. So I used to go there. Now, and St. Anne's, Medipatnam, and St. Francis was in Begumpet. So what I feel is there are pros and cons for everything in life, definitely. There is nothing like 100% perfect scenario for everything.
Great.
So what I feel is I studied myself, I was in school and I also know, after you come to high school and all that, your observation is changing. Then you are hero oriented and, you want to do things that are romantic and, so all that will be there definitely. That is the age also. So, but what I feel is when you are actually studying in a co-ed college, positively, this is the positive side of it, that you are actually from a young age, you are used to these tantrums and used to these, to the girl boy thing, you see. So, no, girls have to be like this and boys are like that. People, our upbringing is different in different households as well. I'm not even talking about society at large. I'm talking about households as well, that, I was talking to one of my friends this morning and what she said is also the same. So from a very young age, the boys are actually in some households not trained to do their stuff. Glass of water, you run and then give the water to the son rather than saying, okay, beta, lelo. The self-sufficiency somehow is not taught to some sons, some boys. So they grow up with that kind of mentality, and it will be difficult for girls who are always, beta, you have to do this, you have to learn cooking, or you have to learn, self-sufficiency,
yeah.
I would say.
Yeah.
Not
but
always cooking, I don't relate myself to women cooking all the time, but yes, self-sufficiency. So there is a huge clash of culture here itself. Boys are brought up like that and girls are brought up like this, though a lot of things are changing nowadays. Like my husband helps me in everything possible. Even it means cleaning. We are living abroad, so obviously we have to do that. So even in terms of cooking, in terms of lot of things. But then I'm talking back home or in a lot of households. So what happens is studying in co-ed probably gives you an idea about these different attitudes and different cultural differences at a young age.
Mm.
Okay, it should, because what happens is otherwise it comes to you as a culture shock. It might come to you as a culture shock. And again, there are advantages like, you feel more secure studying in a girls' school or girls' college, even degree for that matter, because then obviously you are away from the evil eye of them. I'm sorry, I'm just joking. So, there are apprehensions, there are fears, there are a lot of things are happening, unfortunately. So I think the pros and cons are always there. And I find it amusing to note these differences.
Hmm.
And I think it's more our own personal acumen. We have to draw a line between what is right and wrong, whether it is a girl or a boy.
Sure.
When that happens, then these, studying together or not studying together, Eve teasing, Adam teasing, all these probably wouldn't plague us much.
Yeah, I agree. So, last question, ma'am. When you go to a party or event where it's not classical, but, people are dancing. So, how flexible are you? Do you involve into whatever dance is happening there, or you are like, no, I'm a classical dancer, so I cannot do this?
I know, this is also very amusing. So, of course, I do go to, we have like... we've got some groups and associations who do Women's Day and tea and family group attended whenever my diary permits, actually. So from where, I was a cultural secretary to, a certain organization where, you are the cultural secretary. So you are the embodiment of culture and people are actually looking at you like that. So I'll just quote a very hilarious example, not totally related to this, but I'll just tell you. I was in Hyderabad on one of my visits, and I think the next day I was coming back to London, And so I had a lot of, you know, pickles and packing and, you know, last minute shopping and something to pick up for my daughter, etc. So there was this TV channel, a very obviously well-established TV channel, wanted to take my interview. And then because it was almost, you know, I was leaving the next day and I was too informal, jeans and some kind of top. And I just went because it was shopping and I wouldn't have worn a sari. And anyway, I don't wear saris for my shopping. So the most, I don't know, how do I define it? The most informal, you know, very chilled and relaxed. And, you know, I just went off like that, you know. And then suddenly this TV channel calls me and says, we want to take your interview now. And I said, no, I'm actually busy, you know, and then the whole day I'm moving around. So I'm not even sure which area I will be because I have a couple of things on my, you know, on my calendar. So they said, oh, no, ma'am, it's okay. You tell us where you are. We will come there. You don't have to come to the studio. We will come to you. And then I said, okay, what do I do now? obviously, you know, because at that time I was publishing a book, Talapatralu, the manuscripts that were there in British Library. I worked on them almost for 3 years, 100, you know, vachanalu, 100 poems or compositions. So I literally worked quite a lot on it, and then I was publishing. And then at that time, a couple of TVs have interviewed me. I've given bites and interviews and all that. So probably when I was leaving back, this channel has contacted me. And then I said, okay, I'm leaving tomorrow. I mean, shall we do it tomorrow? Then I told them, oh, I'm leaving tomorrow. So they said, okay, ma'am, if you can come 1 hour early to the airport, we don't even mind coming to the airport. I said, oh my God, these are very keen journalists now. So I really, when they were so keen, I wanted to accommodate as well. But obviously, I was in jeans. I would not have talked about Acharya Ramanuja and manuscripts and all that heritage work in a, you know, some top and some jeans and all that. So I said, oh my God, what do I do now? So I had to literally call a friend of mine and I said, can I borrow a sari?
Seriously, you did that?
I mean, I'm actually somewhere. I can't even go back home because I was too far from home. And these people would said, okay, we are coming in an hour or two. And 2 hours, I would not have managed going home and getting ready. So I literally called a friend of mine and I said, please, can you give me a sari? Because I don't have any. And incidentally, what happened just 3-4 days before that, I actually gifted her a sari, and it was so embarrassing for me to
ask the same sari back.
It is a new one, so I don't have to wear yours. I will wear that new sari, and then you can take it back. So I did that. So so coming back to, you know, coming back to culture, and so people see me like that. People, I mean, I'm an embodiment of culture for everybody, which I will not obviously upset that. I'm not against Bollywood or Tollywood or whatever. I'm not against, because that's also a music. That's also a rhythm. People spend their creativity, you know, making those songs and, you know, those works, pieces of work. Yeah, but then if somebody's asking me to do a Bollywood dance, well, you know, I may join them, but it's not like I will do a, I mean, I don't teach Bollywood. I don't do all that here. But I'm definitely, it's
you can't say no,
on many, on you many not be the best. Platforms, it is enjoyed as popular culture. And I do realize and appreciate that. In fact, you wouldn't believe if I say this, there is a PhD scholarship. There is a PhD program, at least let's not talk about scholarships. There is a PhD program with, of course, support to do a Bollywood.
Wow.
As a popular culture.
That's nice. Yeah. That's a good
here topic. In London. Yeah. So when I knew about it, I said, okay, I mean, so much support is given to Bollywood, no doubt about it. Even our classical arts are also given. But I see sometimes I say, ha, classical kaun sunega, kaun dekhega, you know. And I said, kyun nahi dekhenge? Do you promote it? You promote it. When you promote it, people will see.
People will.
You yourself are giving up on our intangible heritage like this. And how can you expect anybody else to, you know. To, but having said that, yes, I did join in some moves and I do that stuff. I do that stuff. Because it's, again, you know, cardio and, you know, all that.
Yeah, so, yeah, I am eagerly waiting to see one of those moves. I request, you know, friends of yours, whoever is seeing this particular video, to share that secret post, tag her and tag everybody and then share it with us.
Oh my God.
Yeah, because you will not share anyway. You will not share anyway. So
yes, you know, it's something like, you know,
some
like,
old memories, you know? Any videos of her, any videos of her,
then
please.
Then you go for a second, do this and come back.
Good one. Thank you. Now the final question. So what would you do if you become the chief minister? What are the areas you would focus on?
Okay. Yeah, from the name of your program, I understand that you are making me the chief minister for 1 minute, isn't it?
Yeah, you have an answer. I mean, you will become chief minister for one tenure, but you will have 1 minute to answer that.
Oh, 1 minute to answer, and I don't become a CM for 1 minute.
No,
I thought it's like I become the CM for 1 minute. What can I do in 1 minute? Excepting, you know, probably signing some, you know, GOs. It's actually quite an intense question. It's not as hilarious as I have replied before. So as the head of the government, you know, as a leader of the government, and also with a person having an artistic background and acumen that I have, probably I would make, not that the schools are not doing it, some of the schools are doing it, but with more vigor, with more, you know, with more, you know, with more objectives, I would probably make arts education a compulsory subject in school. Schools are doing, they have their annual days and sports days and these days, those days. So they are doing a lot of cultural programs, they are doing dancing, they are doing singing. I'm not saying no to it at all. A lot of schools are doing and I appreciate that. But what I'm saying is, we have what is called as 64 kalas.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so 64 arts in our heritage. So probably, you know, for example, you have something called Prahelika. Okay, now this may sound very serious to you, but Prahelika is the art of creating and solving riddles.
Hmm.
Okay, so it is again mental acumen, you know, like you have a lot of riddles, Monday is of, you know, Monday comes 3 days before, you know, we have probably solved a lot of such, you know, puzzles and riddles. But this is an art actually. In our 64 kalas, this is Prahelika, is the art of creating and solving puzzles. So if that is introduced as a discipline, you know, not doing once in a year or twice in a year or not like that. But if you are actually inculcating that as an art into children, they become, you know, they become scientifically oriented, they become more, you know, their creative juices start flowing from that age. So probably, and also being a dancer, and of course, I'm more into performing art. So you have something called Akshara Mushtaka Kathana. Okay, again, please, it sounds very serious and, you know, very complicated, but it is not. Akshara Mushtaka Kathana. Kathana is story and Mushtaka is, you know, using hands, fingers. So this is an art with fingers. This is talking with fingers. And some people in India do that. I see sometimes the videos where, you know, you're doing something with your fingers and actually there is a, you know, there is a story created on a screen.
Yeah.
You know, actually you're doing something here, but it actually looks like, you know, two people going to the war or, you know.
We do it for dogs and all that. Yeah. Well, you know, the power goes off it. Yeah.
Yes. So that is called as Akshara Mushtaka Kathana. It is an art form, a discipline on its own. You know, it's called talking with fingers. So, you know, that, even that kind of forms, which probably not many people are taking up or even know about. What are the 64 kalas? If I sit today and ask, okay, Arvai Nalu Kalalu, we have 64 different types of arts. What are they? The most promoted, most observed, most seen, or most practiced are painting, yeah, chitrakala, painting, dancing, maybe, you know, singing, and you have these five or six which are very famous.
Hmm.
And one more thing, which is in Western world, it is quite, after I shifted to London, UK, I've seen it quite a lot. So that is called face painting, the art of face painting, body painting is face painting. It is called as Visheshaka Chedya. In the 64 kalas, you have Visheshaka Chedya, which is nothing but the art of face painting and body painting. Of course, in here in UK, I see a lot of people, not only Indians, but also others who do face painting. But it is part of our 64 kalas. So if this is given as a discipline, if Forever. Kids or, you know, if people are encouraged to take this art form, which is again a part of our heritage as well, so more number of, you will have more number of practitioners, more number of people doing it, appreciating it, and that's how arts will be promoted. So if I become the CM, and of course environment and plastic, I mean, we have a lot of things, I mean, a lot of things to follow, but I really don't want to talk about that because a lot of people will be talking about that anyway. So green skills and green activities I would promote, and as far as arts are concerned, I would do, you know, such kind of arts which are lesser known, which are lesser practiced. So otherwise these arts will die.
Right.
The arts will die their natural death if people are not promoting it or learning it first. We have to learn, inculcate, promote, practice, perform. Then only you will have all the attention of the world towards us. And India is, people are looking up to India as a world leader. I mean, have been, but it's becoming more and more now. So I think we will have to, as a chief minister, I would rather look at things that are not much promoted, which have to be brought out and, you know, into public domain. And, you know, I would do that kind of things.
Good. It's a good point. I think some of these arts which are like dying, as you said, natural death, I think we should do something about it. And, you know, I think this might be the right time to at least highlight these 64 arts one by one. So do let us know if you have anything we can educate, to promote or at least educate. And if there are some kids who are doing one of these arts during these particular dates, apart from learning online, these classes which are going online, I think this might be a very good time where people have attention. People are ready to do some of these things. So I think we can do it and, do some steps, baby steps to take that happen. But thank you, Lord.
I said Prahelika, which is puzzle solving and creating,
right.
And Visheshaka Chedya, which is face painting and body painting. And I said, you know, the talking with fingers. That is something which amazes me. What we have, we follow Natya Shastra, we do all the, you know, all the mudras that we have, Pataka, Tripataka. I mean, this is also an art form here, and you don't find a lot of people doing that. And what we do, a lot of us will sit in the chairs and appreciate, wah, 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 wah. But then, you know, some of us at least can try to do more about it, try to find out if there are any texts, who are the practitioners, who are the artists who are actually, you know, doing that. And then probably support them, where required, fund them, let them take classes, let them, you know, share the knowledge and the skill. This is something I think we should do.
Should continue doing it. I agree. So thank you. Thank you for taking time out and joining this. It was really nice interacting, especially your college days and those mischievous things you've done. I'm sure we'll have a lot of comments to answer and a lot of friends who would join this. And yeah, friends, I'm still waiting for that particular video. Do post that video if you see dancing those dance numbers. Hey, even it is old, no problem. There might be some video out there on the mobile. But yeah, good interaction,
so,
and lot of learning.
I'm not an ET, you see. I'm not an extraterrestrial person. I do enjoy everything. But then, of course, within our own limitations, we try to operate within our own limitations.
Yeah. Thank you. And any cause, anything which you are doing with respect to community service, women empowerment, we couldn't talk much about it in the show. But any activities in these areas, do let us know if, you know, we as a circle or friends, me, myself, will try to do our best to spread the word out. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ravi Shankarji. We'll be in touch with you. And thanks a lot once again for having me on your platform. Thank you.
Most welcome, Adi. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you, friends. Have a great evening.